Hi, I'm Ann Neumeyer. I'm a pediatric neurologist from the Boston area, and I'm going to talk about signs, causes, and treatments of irritability and aggression in adolescents and young adults. We'll start by talking about what causes irritability and aggression in autistic adolescents. So as a medical doctor, I tend to think more medical. And so what I'm going to talk to you about is the medical things that I look for that might be making some baseline aggression and irritability much worse, or might even be causing baseline irritability and aggression. One of the things I always do is I look at the physical exam, and so I'll talk to you about what I do during the visit and what are the things that I'll look for in a physical examination that might be important. And I'll talk about some medical and neurological testing that we'll do. And then I'll talk about irritability and how I see that related to pain and some neurological disorders in autism that can cause irritability and aggression. And then after lunch, we'll talk about some other medical diseases that can cause irritability and aggression. So right here on the skin is a little pale spot. And that's an ash leaf spot. And I put the picture up here because when I look at kids, you know, and I want them to undress, it's because I'm looking for things on their skin even that might give me a clue about what's the underlying cause for their autism, or what might be a concurrent issue that we need to address. And if a child has a lot of these little, those little pale spots, and we call them ash leaf spots, then they might have an underlying epilepsy or condition which might be aggravating irritability and aggression and causing seizures. So we look for genetic disorders and concurrent diseases. So just so you know, in a study that was done in Boston with the Autism Consortium, we found about 15% of children who had, you know, what was 5 years ago the newest genetic testing, they had genetic abnormalities. And some of them were Fragile X syndrome, which is a condition that is found in up to 20% of children with autism. Some of the children had tuberous sclerosis, which is the disease that I just showed you with the ash leaf spot. Up to 60% of those children have autism spectrum disorder. And then there are other genetic diseases called Angelman syndrome, Sotos syndrome, neurofibromatosis, Smith-Lemli-Opitz. All of those together are about 5% of children with autism. And then Rett syndrome is a specific autism syndrome that it looks a lot like autism, and we see that mostly in girls. So there are certain findings that we use that can help identify diseases in autism. We look at the head circumference. You always see them checking the head circumference. Well, one of the reasons is that in one of the syndromes, Sotos syndrome, you have a very large head. And in Rett syndrome, the girls typically have a small head, and the head doesn't grow as well, so it the difference seems more marked in adults than in children even. The muscle tone of some children is really low. They're really floppy, the children, and we see that in Angelman syndrome, some children with cerebral palsy, and some children with mitochondrial diseases. And then I talked about looking at the skin. Sometimes I'll use a blue light because the blue light highlights the white spots, you know, those fluorescent lights that makes everything white. And I'll use that to look for markings on the skin that we see in neurofibromatosis and tuberous sclerosis. And some children also just look funny. They don't look like their parents. Their eyes may be too close or too far apart. They may have very large ears. And so I'll look at the appearance, the overall appearance of a child for diseases like Fragile X and Smith-Lemli-Opitz. So genetic testing, pretty much every child has with autism will have chromosomal testing, and I don't do all of the tests right now because we have problems getting insurance to pay for it, but hopefully in the next couple years we'll have that issue resolved. So we do tests looking at the chromosomes, making sure they have the right number. Nowadays, the newer test that we do is called a chromosomal microarray, and that's a more specific test that looks for smaller changes in our genes. And there's certain diseases, like Angelman syndrome that we mentioned, Fragile X syndrome, which is mostly in boys, and that can cause some intellectual impairment as well as the floppiness and a funny appearance to the child. And then there's another group of disorders that are called mitochondrial disorders, and these involve the energy factories of the cell. So children with mitochondrial disorders, they might have seizures, they might have some hearing loss, they might have vision issues, they might have GI issues, and they might be the kind of kids that seem to fatigue a lot. They don't have the energy to do things because their energy factories, the mitochondria in the cell, aren't working properly. Nowadays, we also have whole gene studies where they're just looking at the whole genome. It used to be these tests worth thousands and thousands of dollars, and now the price is coming down so that I would imagine in the next 5 or 10 years that it'll be under $1,000 to have that test done. So we do genetic testing on pretty much everyone. Electroencephalograms, those are the EEGs. I'll show you a picture later where they put the leads all over their head. I typically don't do those in every child because it's hard to put leads on a kid and keep them still for 45 minutes. And there's no reason to do it because the majority of children will have normal EEGs. Sometimes we do sleep studies also, and I'll talk about that later. MRI scans, typically I don't do. There has to be a reason for me to do an MRI study. First of all, putting a child in an MRI scanner is not fun. Again, you have to stay very still. There are loud noises. It sounds, there's big clanking noises of the magnets moving, so it's not a good place for a child with autism. And most kids, actually, under the age of 5 end up getting sedated. So there has to be something abnormal in the child's exam, or the kid has bad headaches that would make me concerned. But I won't do a routine MRI in a child with autism. So if their behavior changes and the child's moving differently, then I might do an MRI study, but typically I don't. So there are metabolic studies that we'll do, looking at how the body breaks down proteins. So we'll look at amino acids and organic acids. How the body is using energy, and for that we'll look at lactate and pyruvic acid. Make sure the thyroid is functioning normal. And the cholesterol, because that sometimes tells us whether the child has a certain syndrome. So those are some of the more common tests that we might do. When I first see a child, I'll do a medical assessment. And then when do I dig deeper? Well, if the child doesn't look like their parents, if they appear dysmorphic, the large ears or the ears are rotated or they're funny shaped, if the eyes are too close or too far apart. If the child seems to be going along, you know, fairly typical or maybe a little delayed, and suddenly after the age of 3, there's a regression that the child loses language after the age of 3. So as opposed to the normal 15-month losing some of their language, that would make me concerned that there's another medical illness going on. Similarly, if the child loses milestones or loses an ability to do something, they were climbing stairs well and they're not climbing stairs anymore, or they've lost a motor skill like writing as an older child, that would make me very concerned that there's something medically going on as well. They lose their activities of daily living. It might be they're not toilet trained. That would be a concern to me. Their self-stimulatory behaviors or self-injurious behaviors go up. another reason that I might start thinking, is there something medically going on? If the child is in a developmentally appropriate, you know, well-monitored, well-taught school program, and sometimes I need to send somebody out to take a look and make sure, and they're not making progress after a year, then that would also have me concerned that there's something medically going on that's impairing the child from their learning. And there might be some other history, such as a seizure disorder, which would cause me to do a further workup. So we're talking medical right now. What is the cause of regression or aggression? So one thing that I see a lot of is pain. Because if you're not comfortable and you can't really express yourself, then you're going to express it. If you can't express yourself verbally and say, I have pain, then you're going to get irritable and you might get aggressive. So pain is very important. There are a number of diseases, neurological diseases, that are comorbid or occur along with autism. And if those get worse, then they can make a child regress or have aggression. There are medical conditions, typical medical conditions. It might even be an earache in a four-year-old or a three-year-old. Well, that's going to make a child more irritable and aggressive. And then there are a lot of psychiatric disorders, which Dr. McDougall is going to address, that can exacerbate the aggression or regression. And psychosocial stressors, and it might just be that a family member went off to college or there's a new teacher in school, and that can be very distressing for a child who likes routine. So expression of pain. Nonverbal children don't express discomfort or pain with words, they do it nonverbally, and sometimes the pain can exacerbate autistic behaviors. So there's so many behaviors that can be indicators of pain. Some children will just grimace or wince when they have pain. Some will bang on their heads. I've seen a lot of kids doing that, and you don't know, is that just a typical behavior or is that an expression of pain? So we end up being detectives. They might bang their chest or bang their bellies or press their bellies up against something because they have pain. Gritting their teeth, eating a lot, constantly putting things in their mouth can be an expression of, it might be dental pain, it might be something in their mouth, it might be something in their throat. Mouthing food or non-food items is common, and a change of gait. So a child isn't walking the same way. And it might not just be a behavior, but it might be that they have hip pain or that they broke a bone. Postural changes can also be a manifestation of an underlying pain. A change in the tics or the quality of the tics might be an expression of pain, as well as a dyskinesia or a funny movement that the child is doing. And also not using the painful part of the body is quite common. Vocal behaviors that are expressions of pain. So verbal tics are common, screaming, throat clearing and swallowing. Constant throat clearing and swallowing very frequent are common in children who have reflux. Scripted speech referring to body parts, doctors, or pain are also seen. The child might just be talking about the doctor, but that might be because they, in some way, are trying to communicate that they have pain, but they don't have the words to do it. Moaning, sobbing or crying without reason, or aggressive vocalizations. So irritability, sleep disorders, and noncompliance are other expressions of pain. And the problem is that a lot of them are behavioral. So you try to use behavioral techniques, but sometimes when they're not working, it's because they're not addressing the underlying problem. Sometimes they work great. But you always have to think, is there something else going on? A couple years ago, they looked at the prevalence of disorders in children with autism and found that children with a sleep disorder had 52% of the children had sleep disorders, 51% had food intolerance, 59% had GI dysfunction, 14% had epilepsy, and mood disorders were high as well as aggression. Only 12% didn't have any of the above. So there are lots of different studies around the country that have been done that have similar numbers. They're not all the same, but they're pretty similar. So the important thing to know is that there are a lot of concurrent issues in children with autism that we need to look at. So what I'm going to talk about now is medically comorbid conditions, so the medical ones that we see or the neurological ones. So I'm going to talk about sleep and epilepsy, headaches and migraine, and the GI, so sleep. So most people know what it's like to have a child who won't sleep well, and it's torture. And up to 83% of children with autism have sleep problems, compared to 26 to 32% of typical children. So even typical children, 32%, that's like a third of children, have sleep issues. And most parents have experienced that at some point. So it's pretty much the most common psychiatric disorder or neurological disorder. So in typical people, even, sleep disorders influence our learning, both in children and adults. If you deprive people of sleep, their cognitive function worsens, their verbal abilities worsen. After I would work overnight in the hospital, we'd all say goodbye at the end of the next day. So we were completely sleep deprived, and everyone would say, don't fall asleep at the traffic light and drive home safely, because we all knew that our cognitive performance was pretty bad at that point. So motor skills worsen, visual motor skills worsen, your spatial abilities worsen, and then your creative abilities also worsen. So sleep deprivation really impairs your performance. Now, in a typical population, it also impairs your flexibility to change. It alters our emotional state. We get irritable. We get non-compliant. We have increased aggression and impulsivity and more behavioral problems. Well, doesn't that sound familiar? Because we see all of these things with autism. So and this is in a typical population. How do we determine if a child has a sleep disorder even? So we start out by doing subjective analysis. And subjective analysis is when you ask the parents, how is your child sleeping? And they'll tell you what's happening. And there are questionnaires that you can give people. And there's a whole bunch of sleep questionnaires. And people can fill out when they're going to sleep and when they're waking up. And so you get an idea of how much the child is sleeping. And usually that's pretty good, but sometimes it's not enough. And then we need to do objective sleep studies. So the little child here is hooked up to polysomnography. It's kind of like an EEG. And they have leads all over their heads and on their chest. And it's not very comfortable, especially for someone who has a lot of sensory issues. But it gives us a lot of information about how the child is sleeping. Then the little wristwatches here are actually monitors that measure conductance in their skin. And that's a newer model of assessing a child's sleep overnight. It's called actigraphy. And that is a much more tolerable way of monitoring and learning about how a child is sleeping during the night. And that can even be done at home, because the sleep studies done in the hospital, they're so hard to do because the children are so upset about it that I don't always find that they give me a lot of good information. This is what you get when you have a polysomnogram at night. And it shows, these are EEGs, and it shows the different stages of sleep. So stage one is just a low grade of sleep, and 2 is a deeper stage of sleep, and then stage 3 and 4 is real deep sleep that we have, and you get these large delta waves on the EEG. And then when the child or adult is dreaming, then you have an EEG that looks like that. The other thing is, here we have leads on the chest, so you can see how someone is breathing. And that's very important because there's some disorders of sleep that affect breathing, and so we'll go over that. So insomnia is the most frequent complaint of parents of children with autism. And there's one of the reasons for that is there's a strong behavioral component around learning to sleep. Children with autism have difficulty settling. Self-soothing is poor in children with autism. And it doesn't seem to matter what subtype of autism you have, whether you're low-functioning or high-functioning. Children seem to all, many of these children have difficulties falling to sleep. There is a study done in 2004 that looked at subjective findings in children with autism who have difficulty sleeping. If you have fewer hours of sleep, screaming during the night, increased reactivity to noise at night, poor sleep quality, or increased awakening, all of those will lead to increased stereotypies and decreased socialization in a child with autism. And this study was done with questionnaires of families, and it's what we kind of know already, is that if you don't sleep well at night, then your behavior is going to be worse the next day. Objective findings, so the last study was a subjective study, and this is an objective findings. When they do the actigraphy or the polysomnography, they find that children with autism sleep less. They have a harder time falling asleep. They have a harder time maintaining the sleep, so they'll wake up more. And they have a harder time awakening in the morning. Actually, they awaken too much during the night. Most kids don't have a problem waking up in the morning. So objectively, they have a harder time falling to sleep. That's sleep latency. So then if you break down the sleep, remember how I showed you the EEG with the different stages of sleep? For some reason, they seem to have more deep sleep. That's the stage 3-4 sleep with the big waves that I was showing you. They seem to have less rapid eye movement sleep. And for some reason, it seems that the rapid eye movement sleep is actually quite helpful for learning. So if you don't have a lot of rapid eye movement sleep, then it can impair your learning. And they seem to have fewer sleep spindles. And I think I have a video, a picture of that in the next slide. And those are just little spikes on the EEG part of the polysomnogram that you'll see. And then they also have less rapid eye movements during the sleep. So the little movements, when there's one phase of sleep where when you're dreaming, your body is almost paralyzed, but your eyes move a lot. And during that phase of sleep, the eyes aren't moving as much in children with autism. So what are the causes of a sleep disorder? Behavioral issues, as I mentioned, the core deficits of autism make it much harder for someone to fall asleep. Because of the transitioning difficulties, because of the behavior difficulties, challenges with routines, learning routines, keeping to routines, challenges with limit settings. It's hard for parents to set limits with a child who doesn't want to follow a routine. And then I didn't write here, but anxiety is another issue. The change in sleep, going from an awake state to a sleep state involves a lot of changes, and if that makes a child anxious, then the anxiety is going to increase, making it even harder to fall asleep. So why do children with autism have sleep disorders? It seems that their circadian rhythms are different. Now, when we sleep, we all sleep for short increments of time. So we'll sleep for 3 or 4 hours, and then we'll wake up, and then we'll fall back asleep, and sleep for 3 or 4 hours, and then wake up. And most of us roll over in bed during that first wake up and don't even realize that we've woken up. But if you have a lot of anxiety, then your circadian rhythms are not right, then you may wake up more, and then you may stay up. So that's why, like, some kids are waking up at 4 in the morning, and they're up for the day. And that's what parents are living with, is their child whose rhythms are off. The other thing is that melatonin, which is a hormone that's involved in sleep, is dysregulated. So the melatonin is dependent on your sight. So when the sun goes down, then the melatonin goes up. And so the brain recognizes that the sun's going down, and then the melatonin is in the pineal gland. It's secreted there, and that regulates the body's internal sleep-wake cycle, and it sends a message to the hypothalamus, and then messages are sent around the body that it's getting time to go to sleep. So there are genetic findings that one of the genes that's involved in in producing melatonin isn't working as well in children with autism. We also know that if you just even look in the urine of children with autism, if you measure how much melatonin they have in their urine, children with autism don't have as much as typical children do. So they're not making as much. One of the other causes of sleep disorders is other medical or neurological disorders that may be impairing sleep. So we talked about the effect of poor sleep and that it exacerbates autistic behaviors and learning, increases repetitive behaviors and anxiety there. The other very important thing is if there are many effects, trickle-down effects of a child who isn't sleeping well, and those are on the class, because if the child is aggressive or irritable, then it's going to affect not just the child who didn't sleep well, but it's going to impair the learning of the rest of the classroom. It affects the teachers. It certainly affects the families. I have many families who have the child sleeping on the couch with the TV because they don't want him upstairs next to the bedrooms of the other children, keeping them up at night. So there's this kind of bad cycle that goes on because the child has now learned the only place they can sleep is on the couch watching TV, and that's not a good place for a child to learn to sleep. The other important thing is parents often assume that the sleeping is their issue, it's not a doctor issue, and they may not talk to their doctor about the fact that their kid is waking up at 4 in the morning every day, or that the child is waking up many times during the night. So the sleep often isn't addressed. And of course, parents need sleep too. The medical issues, epilepsy, GI disease, so I mentioned anxiety already. Mood disorders, depression can also cause anxiety, affect your sleep. Pain can affect your sleep. And then there's some other disorders. This right here is somebody who has restless leg syndrome. And I have a couple kids who've had that. And it's this feeling that you want to move your legs all the time. And if you have that feeling, you can't sleep well. And the only way, sometimes you can figure it out because the parents are telling you that the kid's just moving all the time in bed. Their legs are moving all the time. And sometimes you only figure it out when you bring them into a sleep lab and you do that polysomnography test. And the actigraphy is new enough that I don't know whether it can detect that. I suppose if you had the bracelet on the leg, then you might notice it. Restless legs can also affect arms, though. And then the other disorder is sleep apnea, and especially in children who are heavyweight or children who snore at night. Sleep apnea is a common cause of a sleep disorder. And for children and adolescents, sometimes it's just that the tonsils are so big that it's kind of blocking their breathing passages. And when you fall asleep, your muscles relax in your mouth and in your throat. And so then if you have large tonsils or heavy set, then the breathing is impaired. So normally what happens is right here, you should have unobstructed breathing. And the tonsils are right back here in the back of the throat. You stop breathing and then you kind of wake up. Some people wake up, they might get very pale, and they actually, the amount of oxygen in their bottom drops to a dangerous point. And people who have sleep apnea are quite irritable and may not learn well, they may not gain weight properly, and they certainly are waking up a lot. And some people don't even want to go to sleep because it's not a good experience to wake up without, you know, that feeling that you can't breathe. So the other thing with restless leg syndrome is that's very important is that iron deficiency can cause that, and some medication withdrawals. So another test that if somebody is having sleep disorder, I might check an iron just to see whether they're iron deficient, because an easy way to treat restless leg is just to give iron supplements. And sometimes we have to give other medications for that. And sleep apnea, hopefully it's just surgically correctable with a tonsillectomy, because the other option is that is losing weight, or then they get these masks, which most children won't wear. But I do have one child who loves Star Wars, and he has a Darth Vader mask, which he happily wears. Behavioral treatments for sleep. Okay, so this is kind of like common sense that every parent should do anyway, but it's especially important in children with autism, and that is that you establish a sleep routine. That every night you have the same activities that basically take place. If it should take place about the same time also. You provide a comfortable sleeping environment for the child. So that would be in a room that's pretty dark, but not completely dark for some children. It's a bed. It's got not too many blankets, not too few. It's not too hot, the room. So temperature, it's got the right clothing textures, because some children get very irritable with certain clothing, so you want to make sure they have the right clothes and the right bedding textures also. So consistent bedtime routines. So you pick four to six bedtime activities every night, and you always do those in the same routine. And then you maintain a regular schedule. So if you're going to go out at night and you know you're going to be back later, that's harder for the child. And so maybe somebody else is doing that regular bedtime routine. And then teaching your child to fall asleep alone in his or her bed. And that's a big deal. And I spend a lot of time with families helping their child to learn to sleep so that they can fall asleep alone in their bed. Because remember how I said you wake up three or four times, or two or three times during the night? And if the way you fall asleep the first time at night is typically the way you want to fall asleep the second or third time. So if you fall asleep the first time and you're snuggled into your parents' bed and it's nice and cozy there, and then you wake up 4 hours later and your parents have quietly brought you into your own bed and there are no parents there, then when you wake up, and the child is going to get very anxious because there's no parents there, I'm in a different place. So the child will patter down the hall, go back into their parents' bed, and go to sleep, because that's where they know how to fall asleep. So it's not always a willful thing, but it's just learning. They know how to fall asleep in their parents' bed. So we spend a lot of time trying to teach families how to teach their kids to sleep in their own bed. And It's a pretty gradual process. And sometimes we use medications to help because there's a lot of anxiety around sleeping, but there's a huge behavioral component about teaching about falling to sleep alone in the bed. Because it's so hard to teach a child and so many kids want to come out, some parents will use a gate, just, you know, one or two toddler gates on the door so that they know their child is staying in the room, because some parents just don't wake up when their kids go out of the bedroom. Some parents will use a bell, you know, or a little, one of those little laser trips that, so when the child crosses through, they can get an alarm or an alarm system, so they know their child is leaving the room. It's important in older children to avoid naps during the day. Daytime activities that improve sleep, like exercise, are really, really important. So getting children out for an hour a day to exercise really will help them fall asleep at night. So rewarding good behaviors immediately, not promising the Disney trip, you know, that's kind of not so useful. I'm preaching to the choir here, I suspect. about that, but privileges, offering a privilege, offering stickers, or whatever the reward is for the child that's small and immediate works very well. Extinction, like ignoring, works, but in most families that's very difficult. You can't leave your seven-year-old in bed screaming when you have two other kids, because you want to ignore a behavior, but it's too disruptive at 3 a.m. to do something like that. So generally, it's better to use positive approaches. Just included a picture schedule here. What can you see? Oh, so you know, the first slide is buttoning your pajamas, put on your pajamas, use the bathroom, wash our hands, brush our teeth, get a drink, read a book, get into bed, and then go to sleep. Some children like checklists, some children like to get each picture when it's happening and put it on their picture board. And these can work very well for children. The other thing that we've had some luck with is a bedtime pass. Beth Mallow, who's a sleep specialist at Vanderbilt, introduced this concept to me, and I don't know if other people know about it, but essentially you just laminate a pass on a piece of paper for a child, and they're allowed to use it once during the night. So if the child needs to come in and check the parents once during the night, they've got their pass, they can bring it in, you know, get the quick hug from the parent, or the parent walks them back to their room and puts them back in bed, and that's it for the night. So they get one pass. So for some kids that can work very well. And then if the child doesn't use the pass, they can give the pass to the parents in the morning, and then they get a reward. So it's a way to minimize the interruptions during the night and to promote the child sleeping through. And for some children, that works beautifully. Medical treatments for sleep. First of all, avoid stimulants and caffeine during the day. That's really important that you ensure that there are no medications that might be impairing sleep. Melatonin has been studied in children with autism, and giving between 1 and 6 milligrams about a half an hour before bedtime can improve the sleep of children with autism. For some children, it lasts through the night, and for some children, it only lasts for the first sleep cycle. So you don't know until you've tried it. There are long-acting melatonin products out there, but it requires that the child can swallow a pill. And I recently saw that there may be one that you can open up the capsule with sprinkles, but I don't have anyone who's told me whether it works yet or not. So trazodone is another medication that we sometimes prescribe for sleep, and you know that's not over the counter. So you end up seeing a neurologist or a psychiatrist typically for that. And there are other medications, including clonidine or guanfacine, that can help a child fall asleep. That's sleep. We're going to now start talking about epilepsy.